Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints from SPNN in our 25th year. With me today is Nick Wilkie from the Metropolitan Center for Independent Living. Welcome to the show. My guest today is Laura McMahon from the McMahon family. They have a son who is disabled. They're trying to get their service dog into their public school system, and it's not going all that well, so we'll find out more about that. She is using the Minnesota Center for Independent Living in an outlying suburb of the Twin Cities, so we'll follow the story in a moment, and I'm sure we'll have an update on it as the story, as the rest of the story unfolds. Who are your guests today, Nick?
So with me today, this is another interview about the College Service Corps, and this is something that my organization, the Center for Independent Living, is doing to help alleviate the care crisis. So my guest today is Sam Drost. Sam is an individual that can use care in the community, and she's coming on to talk about her experience as well as tell us about this great program.
And there are hundreds of stories, I'm sure, just like that one.
Right.
So we'll be starting Disability Viewpoints in about 2 minutes, so stay tuned. We'll help you watch. We'll be right back. Laura McMahon and her family have been working relentlessly to secure the needed support for her son Ian to access a service dog Dewey during school. After months of legal barriers, Laura has partnered with the Minnesota CILs to create awareness and make a path for change to students for the future. And we have two special guests on with us today by Zoom, and we welcome them, Abby and Laura. Abby, let's have you introduce yourself and tell us a little about yourself. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. We're glad to be here. Like you said, my name is Abby. I am a program director at a center for independent living called Independent Lifestyles. We are located north in Sauk Rapids, Minnesota. Mm-hmm. We have a variety of programs that serve all people with disabilities, but our core services include advocacy, peer support, independent living skills training, transition, and then information and referrals. So
okay, and before we get going, if people want your contact information, not your home phone number, maybe an office phone number or an email, and if you would repeat it twice, then we got that done.
Yes, I can absolutely. So if you want to reach our Center for Independent Living, you can call me, and my number is 320-281-2036.
Okay, and one more time.
Yep, that will go directly to me. That's 320-281-2036.
And how about an email? Not your personal, yes, but a business email.
Yep, my business email is abbyg@independentlifestyles.org. And we serve the 11 surrounding counties in central Minnesota. So we go as far north as like Kennebec, we're in Chisago, Candiohi, and then Stearns, Benton, Wright, Sherburn, and some of those in between
counties. All over the place.
All over the place, yep. So certainly call for resources and services at any time.
Well, good. Glad to have you on the show. Laura, tell us a little bit about yourself before we get going.
I'm Laura. Thanks for having us.
You're welcome. I hope you're as excited as I am.
I am excited, yes. My son's name is Ian, and I am working to get him access to his service dog at his school, as well as advocate for others so that they don't have to go through the same process that we've had to go through.
Yeah. Okay, so let's begin then, Laura. Tell us how your family and Ian's journey brought Dewey into your lives, and what has the impact of his presence had on Ian?
So Ian has been diagnosed with a genetic condition called SYNGAP1, which is the cause of his autism diagnosis, amongst others. My best friend told me about Can-Do Canines and highly recommended that I apply for an autism assist dog, mm-hmm, also an AAD, for Ian. I applied for the AAD right away, and after a 4-year wait list, Ian received his AAD Dewey.
Great.
Dewey has drastically improved Ian's life and has improved our whole family's life. Dewey is task trained to prevent elopement and to support Ian in calming and redirection during upsets. Mm-hmm. Ian can be supported immediately mm-hmm. wherever we are. And this support enables Ian to venture into new environments and gain new skills while maintaining his safety and increasing his independence.
Great, great, great. You know, if my memory serves me right, a long time ago we had Can-Do Canines on the show here, and I think they did a demonstration. What a fabulous outfit they were. They are.
Oh, they are absolutely
yeah.
amazing.
So from my house to yours, too, I second that. They're just a great outfit. Abby, being yes. part of a Center for Independent Living, what is your role, and how did your organization react to hearing about the McMahon family and the barriers they have been facing?
Right, so Laura and I were actually connected by an advocacy referral from a different Center for Independent Living in the state. So once we met and I learned a little bit more about Ian and their experience, it was right away extremely concerning and disheartening to see mm-hmm. the challenges that were being placed in front of him as a student trying to have an accessible education, and to know that those challenges and barriers were coming directly from the Kimball School District was and is unacceptable. So it's provided an opportunity to support their family, provide some resources, but also create awareness around our community of mm-hmm. the ongoing barriers that people with disabilities and students with disabilities continue to face.
Even today, yes, very much so.
Even today.
What, Laura, what are the first steps a family or a student needs to take to introduce a service animal to a school district, and what was your experience of the initial process, and how has the district responded to your request?
Well, my understanding is that a family needs to merely inform the school district that the service animal will be attending, and then both sides will likely hold a meeting to discuss the logistics. Mm-hmm. I informed the school district when Ian began attending school in kindergarten that he would ultimately get a service dog, as we had already applied.
Right.
I updated them periodically as to where Ian was at on the wait list. And then I also notified them again when placement would be in the next few months.
Right.
Ian received Dewey in May of 2022. And I informed the school that Dewey would attend school with Ian in the fall of 2022. Mm-hmm. So that fall, we held a meeting to discuss the logistics, mm-hmm. including that Ian would need support from his one-on-one para mm-hmm. in accessing his service dog.
Right.
The school's response was that as this would set a precedent for the school district, mm-hmm. they needed to talk with their legal team to determine what was appropriate. Ultimately, the school responded that Ian's one-on-one para or any mm-hmm. school staff would not be allowed to support Ian's access to Dewey, and that in order for Ian to have Dewey, we would have to provide another adult to support Ian's access
right.
to Dewey while at school.
But under the ADA law, there must be some access to that, a workaround for that, I would imagine. I mean, that's another issue. We won't go there, but it just seems funny that, you know, it's just an easy fix is kind of being kind of a roadblock, and that's too bad.
It really is.
So what led to pursuing legal action, and what were some of your biggest challenges when searching for the support for Ian and Dewey's case?
So despite many emails and meetings over the next couple of months with the school, they still refused to allow Ian to have support from the school in accessing his service dog. So as a result, we chose to file a due process complaint to prove that Dewey was necessary for Ian to access his education, which would ultimately require the school to provide that support to Ian.
Mm-hmm.
As this is a fairly niche topic,
right.
it has been challenging to find support from those who are aware of the law and can help advocate.
So, and that's the support is what you need, I think, for advocation.
Yeah.
And that should be fairly easy to get these days, you know.
Yes. Another significant challenge has been the exorbitant financial burden of these legal mm-hmm. proceedings. The school has forced us into legal action by refusing to provide Ian the support, knowing that many families could not or would not be able to take legal action and would have to give up,
nice.
Which this path ultimately denies the child access to their service dog.
Right. I'm running out of time, so I'm going to do these next two questions kind of rapidly. When you met with the initial success from the court's ruling, which allowed for the school staff to be trained and support Ian's success to Dewey, when your family learned of the school's appeal to the decision, what was your reaction as an advocate and a mother? I think more importantly, the mother to Dewey, what was your reaction?
Yeah, I was extremely disappointed. The school's mm-hmm. attorney emailed our attorney 15 minutes before my scheduled training with the school mm-hmm. related to the support for Ian with Dewey to inform mm-hmm. us that they had appealed the judge's decision, which ordered that the court had, or that the school had to provide support for Ian in accessing his service dog, which this was also the day before school started for the current school year.
Right.
So it was just extremely frustrating and disappointing that they were still choosing to fight this court-ordered support for Ian without any basis for appeal.
I'm sure it does, and offline I'd like for our staff to stay in touch with you so we can update the story as it warrants. So I'd like to have you guys back on again. Where does your journey stand today, and how has Ian's ability in school changed, and what do you hope for Ian in the very near future?
Well, during the appeals process, the school is still required to follow the court order and support Ian's use of Dewey, but they are clearly trying to remove that support. So these legal proceedings have greatly damaged the mm-hmm. working relationship
right.
between myself and the rest of Ian's IEP team. So instead of focusing on Ian's education and what is best for him, the school is choosing to focus on what they feel is best for the school.
Hmm.
This has led to a very stressful environment at school and improper support for Ian's behavior challenges.
Do you have individual education plans that they can follow?
Yes.
Okay, good. And the next question is for them. Thanks for being with us, and we'll be in touch in a second here, so stay up online if you can. Abby, as the Centers for Independent Living and Laura continue to work together, what are your next steps to spread awareness on this topic?
Sure. So we are continuing to try to catch some attention of some other local and state news outlets to share this experience and share Ian's story.
Uh-huh.
But right now we're also focusing on meeting with legislators to hopefully get some steam and momentum behind a possible policy change that wouldn't allow for schools to challenge the needs and support.
We're gonna continue this, and if you would stay up for just a minute as soon as I take a break here, we'll exchange information and be in touch. So we'll be right back with more Disability Viewpoints right after this.
Welcome back to Disability Viewpoints. I'm your co-host for this segment, Nicholas Wilkie. With me today is my friend and colleague, Sam Drost. Sam is here to talk about the PCA College Service Corps. This is an initiative that's been in development for a while, but we've been tabling together most recently, and Sam's going to answer a few questions for our viewers. Welcome, Sam.
Thank you so much. Glad to be here.
Thank you so much for coming. I'm gonna kick it right off with just this one. Can you tell our viewers a little bit more about like the origins of the program itself?
Yeah, sure. So I guess it kind of starts off with a community, but I'll start with just a little bit about my story. I was injured when I was 19, sustained a spinal cord injury. And basically after that injury, needed 24 hours of help to do basically every type of basic cares that are needed to live my daily life. Initially, we had a fairly easy time finding PCAs the first few years that I was injured. But we found maybe about 10 years ago, it became more and more difficult for me and my family to find caregivers to help support me with my daily cares. And I wasn't really able to reach out directly to students. And I think in general, we've seen there is just a shortage in healthcare workers overall. What we found is it wasn't just me encountering this, but a lot of people in the disability community. I became part of a group called Get Up, Stand Up to Care Paralysis, and they were all facing the same issues. So we tried to find, to come together to see if we could find a creative solution to help find caregivers for people with individuals with disabilities, as well as kind of find a way to recruit and retain caregivers. So we began really naturally by trying to look at what was available. And with that came the birth of kind of the idea of the PCA College Service Corps.
Awesome. Can you explain a little bit more about what makes this initiative so innovative?
Yeah, I think currently there's a lot of different initiatives that are reaching different segments, like aging adults, maybe different types of people with disabilities, but there's really this gap with people that need large quantities of help throughout their daily cares, people that need 10 or more hours of PCA cares a day. In addition, there isn't that many initiatives going on where they are focused on creating the awards to the PCA students to incentivize them to work with the students. So when we were working with legislators and different groups, they thought it seemed like a win-win for both parties involved.
Awesome. And then you just touched on this a little bit, but can you talk a little bit more about those incentives for hires?
Yeah. So I think what makes this program really innovative is that in addition to getting paid an hourly fee as working as a PCA, you also get awards based on the length of service that you're able to serve. So if you work over 30 weeks providing care to someone with 10 or more hours of need, you will get paid out three different awards of $1,500 each, totaling $4,500 in total. So that can really assist a long way in people that are needing help with their tuition or furthering their career.
Totally. That's awesome. And another thing that I'm thinking about too, Sam, as you know, disability is the one population we all become more of tomorrow.
Definitely.
So there are those of us that don't need cares right now that might need care tomorrow.
Absolutely.
Or don't need cares right now, but 5 years from now we will. Yeah. So, I mean, this is a need that really, really the community can benefit from. And like Sam already said, she's not the only person that this would help out.
I think, and also just adding on, is like it affects not only the individual receiving care, but their entire family, given that a lot of people in my situation have their families providing caregiver supports, but the families are also getting older, the parents are getting older, and yeah, we need to fill the need so that people don't get displaced from their homes and are able to live in the community they choose.
Well, and then to kind of touch on this, like when you always have family members that are doing your care, like that also it does something to the relationship
exactly
with the family members too.
Yes, exactly.
So why not be able to keep, you know, that relationship with your parents as just your parents?
Yes,
it's
exactly.
Huge. One of the other questions I have here. So do you know if there are programs like this that have been established in other places?
I think there are a couple programs in other states that are similar, but really this is the first of its kind within our state. So that's why we were excited about it, and we're looking forward to kind of kicking it off and getting more people with disabilities recruited and students recruited. We were able to secure funding from the Cargill Foundation for the initial kickoff of this program, and then the legislator was able to fund an additional $500,000. So they believe in the program too.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's awesome. And getting the buy-in at several different levels is always important.
Yep. Also, it's a good coordination of kind of a first of its kind of working with higher ed as well. Mm-hmm. So it really connects and bridges the gaps between a lot of different communities.
One of the other things that makes this cool is that if the student workers are in a medical or health related field, it's my understanding that the time that they would spend doing the job would also work towards their service hours as well.
Yes.
Which is huge.
Yeah, exactly. Not alone meeting their service hours, but also really giving them hands-on cares that they might not get until much farther into their healthcare career if they didn't do this job.
Very cool. Let's see here. So we've talked about the benefits for the community, a little bit about the scope of the work. One of the things that we haven't touched on is, Sam, can you talk about the building that relationship with the person that does the care?
Yeah, I think that's what's great about this type of role is you really get integrated with a person's daily life. It's a partnership where I get to know and I want to help my PCA succeed, whether that's in their schooling, but kind of being able to come into someone's house, you're able to go on different outings and be out in the community in addition to really helping someone live as active a life regardless of their disability. So I've become good friends with a lot of my PCAs. And then when they've been able to go on to other careers, I've been able to help support them and then stay in touch. So,
that's awesome. And Sam, what would you say has made the biggest difference for you in terms of care?
I think just finding people that are invested in kind of building that relationship, like you said, and that are as well as able to gain something from it as well. That's when it seems like it is most beneficial. I work part-time and I want to be active, but I need help in order to do that. And I feel like it's everyone's right to be able to stay in their community and receive care. So
that's awesome.
One of the other things that I think is important about this too is providing care like this. It wouldn't have to be the focus of every single moment of your life. Like if you had other career aspirations, you could totally do this and even come back to it.
Yes, exactly.
Like if your life changes a little bit. Mm-hmm. And being able to build that relationship with somebody and work with them when they need the help.
Yep, and in addition, it's a great job with like a lot of flexibility. So people can work hours that work for them and their family as well. So that's always a draw for working with people too.
Awesome. Well, Sam, do you have anything else that you want to share?
I just think I'm excited for this initiative, as I know the crisis can seem intimidating sometimes. And I'm hopeful that if we'll keep exploring these solutions to help people with disabilities in the future.
That's huge. So look for the PCA College Service Corps. We're going to be tabling. We've got some upcoming events at the U. We're going to be at the Reckwell Center a handful of Thursdays in the next couple months. If you know individuals in the community that you think would have a capacity to do this work, we're going to provide you with some links. And we really want to thank Sam for coming on today. And I really hope our viewers have a chance to check out this program and encourage people, because as I said before, the disability population is the one population we all become more of tomorrow. So if you know somebody right now that could use the support, you might know somebody tomorrow as well. Take care, and we'll be back after a few messages.
Well, we've again packaged a lot of, I hope, useful and good information in about a half hour. I want to thank again Nick Wilkie from the Metropolitan Center for Independent Living for being here today, and he's always been a great co-host, and hope to continue. Nick, how were your guests today?
You know, really enjoyed the interview. Really hoping we can get more information out about this program. Wanting to see what college students can do to help alleviate this care crisis. So individuals like Sam and countless other people can get the help that they need and continue to live as independently as possible.
As our population grows, it's mighty important.
Disability is the one population we all become more of tomorrow.
That's exactly right.
Right?
Live for today, you'll be part of our disabled community tomorrow, and it's not a bad community. We're all great people.
We do our best.
We do, man. Again, we've had the Laura McMahon family on, where Ian is attending school, and they're having a little problem with the service dog, so there's been legal action taken, and Abby from the Minnesota Centers for Independent Living was on, and we're going to have them on again because I think there'll be more information, and as it continues to sound like going to the courts, why we'll follow that too. So stay tuned for this story. It's a very good one, and we hope no other family has to go through what they've been through. And with that, that concludes this edition of Disability Viewpoints. We'll hope you'll watch us again as we celebrate our 25th year. I'd like to thank the staff at SPNN for having our production in here and making it look as great as we think it does at home. And we hope you continue to watch. If you have story suggestions and so on and so forth, let us know about that too. For the entire staff here, I'm Mark Hughes. Thanks for watching Disability Viewpoints. Bye now.